everyone. Today we are going... Oh no. Today we are going to be wrapping up our discussion on Tomson Highway's Kiss of the Fur Queen. This is the third and final installment in our discussion, and much like when we asked Candace to do a contribution to Hello Hemlock, I am immediately regretting inviting Emily because she has made me completely redundant, along with Jason. Both of them discussed the kind of language that plays a huge role in this book. And Emily set us up in the first video, so you should definitely watch her video. In case you haven't actually read the book, she gives us a really good summary. And she continues to talk about how music plays a big role in not only the language aspect, but in the lives of the characters that we read about. And Jason builds on that, and he actually contextualizes the residential schools within Canada. So I don't really have anything new to bring to the table, and I apologize for that, but I thought I would just kind of expand on what these two amazing national treasures have already discussed. Down below I'm going to be sharing a link from the CBC. It gives a pretty high-level overview of residential schools in Canada. Residential schools were established with the assumption that Aboriginal culture was unable to adapt to a rapidly modernizing society. It was believed that Native children could be successful if they assimilated into mainstream Canadian society by adopting Christianity and speaking English or French. Skinny, slimy creatures with blackish, brownish, scaly skin, long, pointy tails, and horns on their heads were pulling people from their coffins and throwing them into the depths with pitchforks, laughing gleefully. At the ends of the seven tributaries were dank-looking, flame-lined caves where dark-skinned people sat. Aha! This is where the Indians are, thought Champion Jeremiah, relieved that they were accounted for on this great chart. I'm basically just riffing off of what Emily and Jason have already said, but Jason was saying that there was this effort of assimilation and there was this effort to kind of strip away that kind of native Aboriginal culture, and as well as the language, and force these children to be a part of Western society and Western culture and embrace those morals as well as embrace their God and gods, depending on which church. It wasn't just the Catholic Church that was setting up residential schools. It was also the Anglican and Presbyterian and United. And all of these churches have actually come forward in the past probably 30, 40 years to apologize publicly and formally for the abuses that went on. I don't know what the response to those apologies has been. And the boys themselves actually experienced some abuse in the residential school, which is very interesting because Tomson Highway cites his own experience in a residential school as very good for him because he was from a very far away place in the north. There was no access to certain musical instruments. His family was very musical, but not to the point where they had access to something like a piano. And as Jason mentioned, he is a pianist, and he was able to come to a teacher as well as the actual instrument only by way of a residential school. But just because he had a very good positive experience in a residential school does not erase all of the atrocities and all of the abuses that did happen to many different children throughout the years of residential schools actually existing. One of the accomplishments of the TRC was gaining access to more than 3.5 million documents held by the federal government related to residential schools. First Nations leaders and activists say these files could build a stronger case for genocide in Canada. Established on June 1, 2008, the goals of the TRC include documenting and promoting the extent and impact of residential school experiences, providing a safe setting for former students to share their stories, and producing a report to the federal government on the legacy of the residential school system. Father Gabriel whirled from the makeshift altar and took off after his errant parishioner, knocking host and chalice into the dirt with his robe. Kaputz! Kaputz! You're supposed to be in church, goddammit! The red-furred rodent teased his pursuer. Chicka 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 chicka. Ricocheted through the forest. Come and get me! Come and get me! Come and get me, you ugly little creep, as Kaputz understood it. Wars start when two parties haven't taken the time to learn each other's tongues. So while it was quite incremental and fairly insidious, you can actually look at, especially writing like this, you can look at the way that the Canadian government has treated Aboriginals, and you can see essentially there was a war kind of waging, but it was very one-sided, and there was really no opportunity for the other side, which some might say is the victims, to have fought back in any way. It's interesting when the boys come home for the summer and their family, despite adapting to Christianity, they are still very, they're still very remote, and they still live up north, and they kind of live in a camp of their own, and they move based on the ability to hunt and fish. After having read Joseph Boyden's book of short stories, Born with a Tooth, which revolve quite heavily around residential schools and reserves, in which a lot of the characters in those stories are not embracing Christianity or Catholicism, whereas Abraham, the father of the two boys, does seem to actively kind of embrace Christianity, and he says things in a way that make you think that he has really appreciated what the Catholic Church has done for his family and his community, instead of looking at it as, you know, the government is making us do this, or the church is forcing their beliefs on us and we don't want them. But it's a pretty amicable relationship for Abraham. And when the boys are young, I think this kind of closes doors to them when it comes to the abuse that they have been experiencing. Something in particular that resonated with me was the notion of solitude. And even very early on in the book, when he's still essentially a child, Jeremiah is moved down to the south, and he is working with a piano teacher. He thanked God that he had learned his father's lessons on solitude, how time alone could be spent without need for crying, that time alone was time for shaping thoughts that make the path your life should take, for cleaning your spirit of extraneous, even poisonous matter. Jeremiah's father would tell his adoring children of arguments he had had with the fierce north wind, of how a young pine tree had corrected his direction on his homeward journey and thus saved all their lives, of how the northern lights had whispered truth into his dreams, and his soul was happy, his spirit full and buoyant, his smile a gift from heaven. Time alone, he said to them with just so many words, the most precious time one human being can have during his too few moments on earth. Yes, but Father, he wanted to say from the back seat of a rapidly filling bus, you never told us how to spend time alone in the midst of 500,000 people. Here, stars don't shine at night, trees don't speak. And it just seems like this particular passage could be applicable to anyone in Canada, really, because there is this sense of inherent placelessness if you don't adhere to the notion that hockey is Canada, or you don't fit in with the kind of Anglo-centric version of Canada, of, you know, white male Canada or even white female Canada. Who are you and what do you do? What do you represent within the nation's kind of cultural context? Especially with a country that is so vast, and the starting place for these characters is very literally in the wilderness, and that is still a kind of cultural identity that no matter where you are in Canada, you kind of have in the back of your mind. You may identify with it, you may not, but you still know that it's there. So this notion of sitting on a bus and feeling alone, but not being in total solitude in an environment where you are solitary, that's, to me, feels very Canadian. So I don't really know what to do with that information, but I do think that Tomson Highway might have cracked the Canadian code. For anyone that hasn't already picked it up, I highly suggest you get a copy of Kiss of the Fur Queen. Special thank you to Emily and, of course, as always, Jason for participating. And thank you, Emily, once again for actually picking this book. For all of our contributors that we ask to be on the channel, we actually ask them to be the ones that pick the books. So finally, for those of you who don't know, Hello Hemlock is actually online in the sense that we have a website now. Much like this channel, we are actually going to be having various contributors, so keep an eye out in the month of October to see which international friend of ours we have asked to discuss Leonard Cohen. All of the outtakes of this are simply going to be me coughing. I hope everyone is well, and I can't wait to see you again and talk about Essex County next month. Bye!